I'm a journalist. I've joined Reynolds News. This is 1958, the very beginning of. And I immediately ran slap into a problem. But in those days, the NUJ were a very strong trade union among journalists, and their rule was that you had to serve an apprenticeship for 3 years in the provinces before you could work in London. And they'd signed a deal with what was then called the Newspaper Proprietors Association, I think the NPA, saying that that was what was to happen. And so when I arrived at Reynolds, straight out of the army, I suppose I was nearly 23 or 24, all the loyal staff members said, no, we can't have him here, he hasn't qualified as a journalist. So there was a tremendous sort of battle about whether I could actually even join the staff, even though the job had been offered to me. And in the end, we outwitted them because I went round the back door to the London freelance branch. And because I'd been earning so little in the army from the War Office, £5 a week, I was able, I think, with a little stretching of the point, to claim that in the previous year, my earnings from journalism had exceeded that from my main employer, the army at the time. And I think it was involved with a slight stretch of the truth, but it was nearly there because I'd written for a lot of papers. I'd written for Reynolds News, indeed, which offered me the job. I'd written for the New Statesman fairly regularly. I'd written once or twice for an obscure weekly at the time called Truth Magazine, now out of business. And so we could get it up to sort of, after all, if £5 a week was £2.50, and we could get it up to very near there. And so I got my card to be a journalist, NUJ card, from the London freelance branch. And that meant that the opposition to having me in Reynolds collapsed. So I think there were some old sweats there who rather disapproved of my arrival. Anyway, they were on the whole very nice to me, and it was a baptism of fire in that I think the first week I was writing a political column for it, goodness knows why, I think they knew I was a Labour candidate. That reassured the ownership of Reynolds, who were the cooperative movement. And I was a very young prospective Labour parliamentary candidate, and they thought that meant that I was reliable and safe and all that. But the very first week I arrived, we had the resignation of the Treasury of Thornycroft, who was the Chancellor, Enoch Powell and Nigel Birch. So I was thrown in at the deep end. And frankly, I knew nothing. I mean, I'd been sitting in the press gallery of the House of Commons, well, not the press gallery, the public gallery of the House of Commons once or twice, but I didn't know anything about how the lobby worked or anything like that. And I was thrown in this very raw recruit, very naive. Now, I hadn't helped matters, matter of fact, because I was just trying to work out. I'd written a very unwise article in Town Magazine, owned by Michael Heseltine, and that was all about how politics was covered and individual lobby correspondents' name. But I think I'm jumping ahead of myself. I think that was before I joined the New Statesman, which came afterwards, so better not go to that now. Instead of that, I found myself in this newsroom in Reynolds, and Reynolds is a very worthy paper, but there was something terribly depressing about it, that all the photographs looked as if they'd been taken in the 1920s, and whereas the Sunday Pick would have sort of ravishing girls in bikinis, we had sort of ladies in wholly covering their skin, swimsuits and all the rest of it. And that was because Cooperative Women's Guild wouldn't have anything else. But there was something very depressing about it, and I can hear it now in my mind's ear. You know, you sit there on a Saturday afternoon and there'd be reporters who brought in, you hear this hum going, not the Empire News, Reynolds News here, Reynolds News. And people had never heard of Reynolds, or quite a lot of people you were ringing up, or reporters were ringing up. There's one man I greatly admired, and he wouldn't go into any of this. He'd just say, will you tell his lordship that Mr. Jack London called from London? And I thought he had much more self-confidence than all the rest. Anyway, I would probably have stayed there for quite a time, but I'd only been there about 3 months, and I got a mysterious message to go and see Lord Beaverbrook, who was the great press panjandrum of the age, owned the Daily Express, the Sunday Express, the Evening Standard. And this mysterious phone call, not made, of course, by Beaverbrook himself, came from some minion saying, Lord Beaverbrook would very much like to see you. Will you go and see him next Monday afternoon at Arlington House, which is a very grand block of flats just behind, down from the Ritz off of St. James's in Piccadilly. So I went and duly presented myself, and there was some kind of manservant who admitted you, and he said, sit down, his lordship will be with you shortly. And I sat in this rather alarming drawing room, And eventually I heard a sort of pad of feet, and sort of from behind my back, Beaverbrook appeared. And he had this, you know, slightly unnerving habit of talking to you from behind your back. He walked up and down, and I couldn't see him, he could see me, and he was perfectly agreeable. He finally said, do you want to make mischief, he said. I said, yes, I like making mischief. He said, good, come and make mischief of my papers. So I suppose you could say it was a job offer. And certainly shortly afterwards, I received approaches, I think, both from the Evening Standard, from the editor of the Evening Standard, and from the editor of the Sunday Express, asking me in the latter case to go and be cross-bencher, which was then the political column, had quite a lot of impact in those days. And that was Sir John Junor, the editor, then not Sir John then, he was just John Junor. And we had a long negotiation, lasted through a lot of the summer. And eventually I said, yes, I'll come. And they were going to pay me about double what Reynolds were paying, and it was obviously a step up in the journalistic world. But I remember I went on holiday to Paris, and I just couldn't reconcile myself to a life as a Beaverbrook journalist, or indeed a life on the Sunday Express. And it so happened that that very Sunday, and I think I must have seen it in Paris, the Sunday Express had a really disgraceful story about some poor ordinand who'd been ordained in Ripon Cathedral, and whom they had dug up some kind of gay episode in his past. And here was this man pilloried on the front page of the Daily Express, Sunday Express. He was only about 25 or something, just about to be ordained deacon. And I thought, do I want to live with that as the kind of paper I work for? And I made up my mind I didn't. So I came back to London. I wrote as nice a letter as I could to John Junor, saying I'd changed my mind, very sorry, never heard from him. I think he always held it against me. And I went back to work for Reynolds.